I thank you all. I am very happy to spend time so significantly with you. This is one of the best ways of utilizing time. About 10 years continuously in the evenings I spent teaching about Pythagoras in India. People came and listened to me. Some people took notes. But there is one person who is systematic, who has followed all the classes continuously and tried to understand what Pythagoras was, as a result of which he made a good book on the biography and teachings of Pythagoras. And he made the book in our Indian regional language called Telugu. I made the book published and I made it a textbook in to our students at Visakhapatnam. And last year when I came here, I was astonished to see the great interest sustained by Monique about Pythagoras. She expressed that it is one of her life missions to establish a big institution for the study of Pythagoras and to have his teachings continuously. And immediately I expressed that there was already a book published in India, and then we had good exchange about Pythagoras. I think she arranged one conference last year for me to speak on Pythagoras, and this year she arranged a few classes in which we can have a closer view of Pythagoras' teachings. Of course, it is not possible to have all his teachings during these four classes. But since these are different from conferences, it is quite possible to go into a little more detail. And since we have four classes, we have some opportunity to understand the stature of Pythagoras, who is one of the great masters of this earth planet. The wisdom he was teaching represented the ancient wisdom which was there long before him, and no one gives wisdom as his own. Every great master represents the wisdom, and he never claims himself as the owner of that wisdom. And no one who knows the value of wisdom will possess that wisdom as his, or represent that it is his own wisdom. One who represents that it is his, he is ignorant, because wisdom is eternal. No one of the masters or world teachers claimed it. When Krishna was teaching in the Bhagavad Gita, many places he said, great people teach like this. The ancients teach like this. And so goes the ancient wisdom. Similarly, when the Buddha made his teachings, he said, so say the Buddhas of the ancient times. The word Buddha means the enlightened ones. He said that there were 32 Buddhas before him who taught the wisdom. And he was the 33rd Buddha who followed the footsteps of the previous Buddhas. Similarly, when the Christ was teaching, he said, this is the path of the ancients. and many places he said, this is how great people teach. So Pythagoras also made his teachings like that. And generally, the public knows very little about the teachings of Pythagoras. Many people know that there is one theorem in geometry about the right-angled triangle, and fortunately that theorem goes in the name of Pythagoras. Whereas there are as many as 326 theorems given by Pythagoras, but not exactly on geometry, but about another branch of ancient wisdom, which we can call the spiritual mathematics. Since the subject does not exist in the modern age, we cannot have a name to that subject. So, if we want to study Pythagoras in all his completion, we should have many names newly coined for the new branches of wisdom which are there in his teachings. And in this occasion, I wish to mention that there are 33 volumes given by Pythagoras, given to his direct disciples, and the 33 volumes are handed down from generation to generation till today in the form of teachings, and those who teach are there in many countries of this world. Because Pythagoras do not believe to any one nation or any one country. Even while he was physically living, he represented many countries and nations. No nation could own him or possess him. As a result of which, even today many nations know him independently. For example, the Indians know of Pythagoras even without having a contact with the occidental teachings of Pythagoras. And the occidentals know of Pythagoras, many of them not knowing at all that there are Indian teachings given by Pythagoras. So he is and he was a universal soul. And within these 4 days, we can have an idea of the syllabus of his teachings. That is, the subjects he introduced to the world for the first time, and something also of his personality and behavior, and a little of his birth and career, because it is not of much significance. About 580 before Christ, it is supposed to be the birth year of Pythagoras in Indian tradition. I don't know if the Western tradition tallies with it or not. Is it about the same date? I think. And he was supposed to have born in a city called Samos. And before I go into the detail, I should also express my thanks to my student who followed me when I was teaching Pythagoras and who has made a book on Pythagoras in our regional language. This is the great world teacher Pythagoras. That is how he named it. He has given a book of 176 little pages. And he has a second volume also ready for print. So, I thank my student also because I am now following the syllabus of his book in my teaching. And in those days, teaching was rather traditional and education was considered to be a pious thing. It was considered as something like a spiritual initiation, and when a boy was introduced into literacy, it was made a sacrament. Of course, the tradition still exists in our families in India. In many nations, they have lost the tradition. There are a few, one or two or three nations still maintaining the tradition. We, the traditional families of India, conduct the ceremony of first literacy to the child in his fifth year, just as the ancient Greeks did and ancient Indians did. And Pythagoras was initiated into literacy in his fifth year, and he was educated in the traditional way into language, classics and elementary mathematics, a little bit of geography, which was teaching that the earth was the center of the whole universe and all the other globes are going around the earth, including the poor sun and moon also. So he received the education like that, and before he was 18 he lost his father, and then he wanted to make a journey for higher education. In those days there were three seats of ancient learning. One was Egypt, the other was India, the other was Greece. Of course, today all the three cease to be almost the centers of ancient education. Egypt, there is no center of education in its true sense nowadays. We have the ancient Egyptian education only in books, not in Egypt. And we have all the ancient Greek education only in books, not in the present Greece. Similarly, ancient Indian education we have in books. But luckily, we have about 10% of people who are educated still in ancient Indian education. So in those days, these three were the holy centers of education and ancient wisdom. So Pythagoras, in his 18th year when he lost his father, he wanted to make pilgrimages to the great places of Greece, Egypt and India. There was a great man in those days by name Thales. The word indicated the sun god. He was almost a light of his time, one of the grand masters of ancient wisdom. He lived in Egypt. Many people from many parts of the world went to him to see him, and some people lived with him as his disciples. Pythagoras started to see him, and he went there. The people of the merchantmen of one ship helped Pythagoras to go to Egypt, and he went there and he saw the great master Thales. But in those days, wisdom was given only to the select students. It was not sold for money. And there were no commercial educational institutions, just as we know, we have now. And they didn't appeal to the public that they can come and purchase education, because people had better methods for livelihood than education. And education was something pious. So people were not ready to give education to those who wanted to commercialize it. Especially three subjects. One is medicine, the other is law, the third is God science or theology. These three subjects were kept with great jealousy away from people who do not believe in giving it free of cost. For example, medicine was given only to those who wanted to do free service, and the governments used to pay the doctors. The doctors had to go round the towns and villages and heal and come back. So also the lawyers are expected to help the people in law, whereas the government helped the lawyers by paying. They had little pockets in the back of their gowns, so that when anyone was pleased can put some money in the pocket. Even today, the gowns of lawyers contain those pockets. Though doctors and lawyers take money from face to face, still the symbolic pockets in the back exist as a mockery of the present humanity. Because humanity had courage that they could live, whereas in the present century, living has become a problem. Everyone is immoral enough to think much as to how he has to live. That is due to the difference in the setup of society. And the present state of affairs clearly proves that our social setup is awfully unscientific and wrong. We are in a transition period, a miserable and helpless period, where the human being lives always hunted by fear. And once again, we can hope of living a life without fear, just as the human being lived in the ancient days. And once again, wisdom may be considered as a pious thing. So the masters were not kind to Pythagoras when he first went to Egypt. Much time was spent, and he was put to many tests and trials and tribulation. He stood all the tests, and they could understand that he was not an ordinary soul. They were fully convinced that he was born to do something great, and they allowed him to be a student. Soon they understood that he was born to do something which they could not do. So, with great veneration, they began to teach him, and they began to pour out their own wisdom and heart to him. Whichever master he approached, he became the darling child of that master. That was one of his privileges. Not only that, there is one rare thing in Pythagoras. You know, the Jesus Christ remarked once that no prophet is respected in his own place. You know, when Jesus Christ became the world teacher, when he was worshipped and hailed by everyone as the Lord, he was invited to his own place. When he went there, people laughed at him and said, "This is the fellow who was born to the unmarried lady." That was the state of ignorance in his place. Then he smiled and remarked that no prophet will be honored in his own place. But Pythagoras was a great exception to that. He was a greater success than any prophet in that respect. When he returned to Greece as one of the grand masters of wisdom, he was honored by his own people and considered as a great light of wisdom. And when people talked about him, they used the word the light, the Lord, the master. That is how they used to talk about him. So in this respect, he was a great exception. He was not only a darling of his teachers, he was loved greatly by his own disciples and the people of his own place. Of course, there were a few people who disliked him. That is because jealousy exists at the bottom of human heart. That is the defect of human nature and not the defect of the master. And he toured in Egypt. And then when he was 22 years of age, he met almost all the masters of Egypt and had his teachings from them. He was a student in the centers of learning, international centers in those days. For example, Heliopolis, Memphis, Delphi, etc. And yes, he was initiated into the secrets of mathematics, especially the geometry of those days, which was different from the geometry of the present day, and the science of the stars and the galaxies and solar, which is much different from the astronomy of the present day, because the science of stars included in those days astronomy, astrology, astrobiology, astrolatry, astromedicine, astropsychology, and the science of correspondences. These are the various branches which the science of stars in those days included. For example, if you read the treatise on medicine by Hippocrates, you will find the science of correspondences and the relationship between the zodiac and the human constitution, the functions of the various organs in the body and the planets, and how the human constitution is a working whole, how it is holistic, how the solar system is a single personality, and how the human personality is a little photo of the solar system. Such sciences, which do not exist in the modern times, they existed in those days, and he was permitted to be a student into those sciences. And also he was a student of the science of symbolism. It was a sacred science into which the human being is trying to make an entry once again from the 19th century. There are many institutions in the modern time about the science of symbolism. For example, the inner side of Theosophical Society and the various institutions called the Freemasonry Lodges and many ritualistic schools that are having the secrecy of their own, all trying to teach something of the science of symbolism. But yet, to many people, it is still a dead science, because even the senior most members of the Masonic Lodges and Masonry, they know symbols only as corpses of a science. Still, much work is there. There are masters who teach the science in its real sense. And yes, an institution is there going on, branches of which are in every country, including the countries of the present Republican group. Only one institution is there. The students have their branches in almost all countries. And the institution is running from the time of Pythagoras till today continuously. That is how Pythagoras started the institution. Sure. He has laid the foundations in such a peculiar way that it is impossible to stop the institution. Sure. Or to commercialize the institution. And he has arranged a peculiar process of natural filtration. People filter themselves away from the institution because of their personal defects and ignorance. And they can approach and make an entrance into the institution only according to their ability and their fitness. Neither money nor authority nor degrees nor diplomas make us enter into that institute. But when the moment comes, automatically we enter into that institution and study as students of the Pythagorean institution. Still we can live in our own country, serve our own nation and our own town and city, do our own duties to our own society, to our own family and neighbors. And inevitably, a student of the Pythagorean International Institute is a law-abiding and a law-respecting citizen who never makes a revolutionizes his virtues, because he believes in revolution, but not against the society, not against the government, not against the neighbors, not against those who are stronger than ourselves, not against those who are weaker than ourselves, but only against ideology and ignorance in a silent and effective way. So, no student of the International Pythagorean School can be found a member of any political institution of the modern age or taking part in any political movements of the modern age of any country and any nation. This has no compromise. This is one of the truths of the Pythagorean institution. You can imagine what type of nature he was having. A great man who has established such an institute must be having only a positive way of approach to everything and having no negative aspect towards anything at all in his personality. This is the one thing towards which we have to make an approach, an attempt. And he was taken as a member of the then existing ritualistic institutions because he knows what is the value of a sacrament, that is, how to conduct a sacrament and what change takes place when a sacrament is conducted, how the consciousness makes an expansion, how such an expansion is not possible in the intellectual way of education. One who knows the procedure of making the consciousness expand, he is called a grandmaster in rituals. Otherwise, a ritual is only a dead ceremony. And real masters admitted him into the science of sacraments, and then they taught him the science of rituals, what are called the holy and sacred rites, and then gradually he was made a master of the holy ritualistic orders, and afterwards he has established his own ritualistic order